Hare Krishna. So, thank you for coming today evening. And today I'll speak on the topic of how. Am I audible behind? Okay. How in our life, when we want to grow, when we want to act positively, grow in our life, sometimes success can come in the form of failure. What do I mean? Success can come in the form of failure. That means that sometimes what we normally think of is good and what we normally think of is bad, in reality it may be the opposite. The Srimad Bhagavatam is a remarkable book for many reasons. One reason is that it forces us to challenge our normal conceptions of what is higher and what is lower. Say, for example, normally devatas are considered higher, asuras are considered lower. The gods and demons is a normal hierarchy across cultures. But the Bhagavatam depicts an extraordinary pastime in which a demon is shown to be far greater than a devotee, sorry, than a devata, than a god. Which is that pastime?
Ratrasur.
Yes, excellent. So, like that, actually speaking, basically what happens is that when we try to look at things, we have a certain stereotyped way. This is good and this is bad. This is better and this is lower. But the Bhagavatam inverts that conception in many, many ways. So, one such inversion happens where the Bhagavatam tells us that sometimes a great person gets bewildered, gets deluded, and in that delusion, there is their success. Normally, we think of success and failure as, I have to give exam. If I pass the exam, it's success. If I fail in the exam, then that's failure. But the Bhagavatam challenges this conception. And this conception is challenged in a pastime that comes in the latter half of the Bhagavatam, in the Mohini Murti pastime. So, the topic some of you may got is that when the source of liberation becomes the source of illusion. The source of liberation is the Supreme Lord Himself. But then He Himself sometimes puts a devotee, and not just an ordinary devotee, a very great devotee, into illusion. Who is that devotee? Whom does Mohini Murti? Yes, Lord Shiva. He puts him into illusion. So, but even in getting into that illusion, actually Lord Shiva is glorified. And Lord Shiva, despite being deluded, is actually successful. So, how this works out, let's look at this pastime to understand this. The devatas and asuras have a constant fight, and while they are having this fight, you know, it's broadly speaking, there are two kinds of people in the world. It says, some people are wise and some are otherwise. And it is not just that, actually the same person can sometimes be wise and sometimes be otherwise. The divine and demoniac forces are present in our own hearts. And if the divine side becomes stronger, then we act wisely. When the demoniac side becomes stronger, we act unwisely. We act foolishly. So, these two are always in a battle inside us. And what happens inside us at a psychological level is reflects a reality that is also happening at a cosmological level. In the universe also, there are these divine forces and the demonic forces, and they are in a battle. And at one particular point in this cosmic battle, the demonic forces start becoming extremely strong. So, at that time, the devatas pray to Vishnu, and then Vishnu tells them, make peace, make peace. Your time is not favorable right now. for doing a particular thing, time is a very important factor. We recognize the role of time. Say, for example, there are certain fruits which may grow in particular seasons. If you want mangoes to grow in winter, mangoes, they will grow in summer season. So each situation requires a particular time. So the Lord tells them that the Kala is pratikul right now. So he suggests to them that you make peace. And when they make peace, actually the asuras, they are attracted to the devatas, not just for their opulence and position, but also because the devatas are said to drink nectar. And devatas are referred to as amara. Amara means those who don't die. And that amara is contrasted with people who live in this world. This is called murtya. Murtya is those who die. However, these are not the only two categories of existence. When the devatas are said to be amar, they are immortal in the sense that from our perspective, it appears to be immortal. It appears to be unending. But they also die eventually. So there are four levels of beings. There is Martya, there are Amara, there are Chiranjeeva, and there is Nitya. So only Nitya are actually eternal. The Chiranjeeva, now these words, the words in scripture sometimes have specific technical meanings and sometimes they have universal generic meanings. So we have to see the word Amara, Nitya, Chiranjeeva can also be used in different contexts. Chiranjeeva can also be simply an Ashirvad. May you live for a long time. Chiranjeeva. But technically Chiranjeeva means that it is one who lives for one lifetime of Brahma. Whereas Nitya alone is eternal. So now the devatas are also afraid to die. And the asuras think that because the devatas get the nectar from, they drink nectar, they drink soma. That's why they live forever. So everybody is actually seeking some method or the other to live forever. And nowadays, in today's world, people may not be looking for some elixir, some drink by which they will live forever. But people are looking for some technology. There are some billionaires who have actually arranged for preserving their bodies in deep fridge. So that they hope in future, when technology learns to develop, or technology develops how to revive a dead person, they hope that we will come back to life. In fact, scientists have even now taken out Einstein's brain from his skull and preserved it. They hope in future when we learn how to revive a person, we will put that brain back in again, we will make another Einstein. So the longing for immortality is there in everyone. So the asuras, they think that the devatas have nectar. And with that nectar, if we get, then we can live forever. So then Lord Vishnu tells the devatas, that you tell them that actually the nectar we have is over. But we can get more nectar. How do we get that nectar? We'll have to churn the ocean. So then they get, the devatas and the asuras get together and they start churning. And the churning goes on and on and on. The churning itself is a long pastime. And there's a lot that could be learned from the churning also. But we are not, we won't churn the churning right now. We'll move forward from there. So finally, when the churning gets done, and initially poison comes out, they face a lot of obstacles, but eventually various gifts come and finally the nectar comes out. Dhanvantri comes and gives the nectar. When people are running a marathon, it often seems like the final lap is the longest lap. Although the lap is the same in each round, but when they are running after, say, we're so tired. So it can appear it is so long. And yet, for some people who are very, very tired, the lap may seem to be very long. But as you start seeing the finishing line, then suddenly a surge of energy comes. and that surge of energy rejuvenates them and they run very fast. So now the asuras and devatas have been churning this for a long time, and it's a team effort. So the agreement was that when the nectar comes out, both of them will drink it. Now for all of us, when we see something tempting, certain desires arise within us. Now the difference between, say, civilized people and uncivilized people, it's not just that uncivilized people they dress in particular ways, or they wear some strange kind of things on their head or things like that. We might think those are kind of uncivilized people, but that is not the main difference. You know, the main difference between civilized and uncivilized people is how one can restrain one's impulses. Say Prabhupada gives an example that if we are walking along a market and we see some vegetables or fruits that we like, then we will pay some money and then take it. But say if a donkey is going through that market and the donkey sees that fruit, what will it do? Immediately put its mouth there and start eating it. So the donkey has no capacity to restrain its impulses. It'll just do what it feels like doing. So all of us get impulses, and when those impulses come, at that time people get pushed in particular directions. So astrology sometimes tells that some people have a daivi pravritti, some people have a asuri rakshasi pravritti. Now what does that mean? It's not that the people who have rakshasi pravritti will have some horns coming out of their head or teeth coming out of their mouth. No, all that it means is everybody has impulses, but when somebody has a demoniac mentality, once the impulses come, the impulses push them so forcefully that they cross over ethical boundaries. They cross over boundaries of morality, of decency, even of humanity. Now, most people, if they are civilized, if they are hungry, they will try to earn some money. Now, they'll get some money somewhere, first they get some food and they will eat it. If not, they will request someone, give me some food. But if a person who is demonic, that person, if they feel hungry, they will not hesitate to hurt others, to even injure others, to kill others, just to get that. So our normal urges that come for us, to what degree will we go to indulge in those urges? That determines whether our nature is divine or demonic. Everybody will get angry. Life is such that we will all get angry at times. But when we get angry, how do we respond? Some of us may just, you know, start, some people just give the others silent treatment. I just won't talk with you. Like small children quarrel and then they say, katti. I won't talk with you. So that is one level of expression of anger. Some other people, if they are angry and we talk with them, they just respond in some unintelligible grunts. They talk, but their voice becomes simply a noise. They don't speak intelligibly. Some people go to the other extreme and just start speaking so much. Start speaking anything and everything that comes into their mind. And just yell and scream, and it's like when anger comes, it's like the flood, that is a dam that is there on the mouth, the dam breaks. And then the flood comes out of them. Now for some people, when they become angry, it's not just verbally they become aggressive. Some people may become physically abusive. They may start picking up things and throwing at others. They may start punching someone. Some people may go even worse. They may actually, if they have some weapons, they may pick up a gun and shoot someone. There are incidents of road rage where somebody is driving and somebody from behind honks. Now, a big difference in driving in India and America is that in the Western world, generally people don't blow their horn. In India, every car, every vehicle writes, "Horn, please." the idea is that there is a fundamental driving assumption which is different. In the Western world, when people drive, everybody assumes that everybody else will follow the rules. And people just drive smoothly. And if somebody doesn't follow the rule, that is how unconscionable that people honk. On the other hand, in India drives, you have to assume that any moment anyone will stop following the rules. Any moment anyone will do anything. And so the idea is, you know, if you're going to go off track, if you're going to come very close to me, then before hitting me, at least you blow a horn so that I'll take precaution. The point here is that some people, they just hear somebody honking at them, they get so angry, how dare you honk at me? I pick up a gun and shoot the person behind. So that's road rage. Now basically, when say anger comes, when desire comes, there can be a range of responses that are possible. And for the divine, their responses stay within civilized limits. For the demonic, their responses go beyond all civilized limits. So similarly here for the asuras, when they saw the finishing line, they saw the pot of nectar right in front of them, then their thin veneer of cooperation that was there, oh, we will work together, we'll get the nectar and we'll share the nectar, that veneer, that covering, that mask just fell off immediately. And that mask fell off and they charged towards the pot. Now the reason why the demons had got the upper hand earlier against the devatas was because they were more powerful. And now they use their superior power to catch the pot of nectar, and then they just left. They just neglected the gods, just pushed them aside and wanted to drink all the nectar themselves. Now, it's one thing that there are two sides, there are the gods and there are demons. So the demons, may for them to neglect the gods, that's also bad because they've been working together. But for the demons, they not only neglected the gods, they started neglecting each other also. They said, I want the nectar and no one else should get it. Not even the gods, even the other demons should not get it. And they started fighting amongst each other. Now, for many people, morality is simply lack of opportunity. That means, people are moral not because they want to follow some higher principles, they just because there is no opportunity to do something wrong. I once saw a cartoon somewhere, they said that a person was caught for speeding. And the cop asked him, didn't you see the speed limit? The person said, I saw the speed limit, I just didn't see you. So the idea is that people think the purpose of following the rule is just so that we don't get caught. If we can avoid getting caught, then there's no need to follow the rule. So morality for many people is simply lack of opportunity. So it's not simply a label that these people we call them, the Bhagavatam call them gods, and these people call them, they are called as demons. Their character is revealed by their actions. So as soon as the devata asuras got the nectar, they fought off, pushed away the gods, and they started pushing away each other also. And all pandemonium, chaos broke out. And they were all very powerful, they started fighting against each other. And the devatas were left dismayed. They had gone along with the plan of Vishnu to make peace with the asuras, with the demons, so that the nectar would be churned. And now the nectar had come, and now they were completely left alone. So at that time, they started despairing. And at that time, Lord Vishnu appeared. And when Lord Vishnu appeared, this is the only occasion in the Bhagavatam where the Lord comes in a female form. And not just he comes in a female form, But he acts also in an extraordinary way over here. So here, when he appears, in this female form. Is nobody knows who she is. She looks is Mohini Murti. Murti means form. Mohini means one who deludes, one who is so attractive, so captivating that she deludes. So Mohini Murti, she appears and she just captivates everyone over there. So whenever anything attractive comes, everybody will get attracted. But again, the degree of attraction and what one may do in that attraction, that varies from person to person. And in the Bhagavatam, when Mohini Murti appears, her beauty is described. And the description of the beauty can sometimes seem a little explicit. It might seem a little disturbing. Why something has to be described so graphically? So there is a purpose for this. Generally, whenever even a transcendental message is revealed, the transcendental message is written, is phrased in a particular style. So the Bhagavatam is a kavya, it's a poetry. The Ramayana is called the Adi Kavya, it's the original poetry. And there are rules for the description, rules for how kavya is to be composed, how poetry is to be written. And one of the rules of kavya is that there has to be shringar. There has to be shringar ras over there. There has to be the description of beauty. And now there can be description of beauty. What is it? It is not just meant to be put in randomly anywhere, but as we put in such a way that it furthers the storyline. So here what will happen is there's a dramatic twist in the storyline. The dramatic twist means that the asuras who have been fighting to get this nectar, when they see this beautiful Mohini Murti, they immediately want to create a very good impression on her. They want to impress her, and in order to impress her, immediately they start behaving as like very nice gentlemanly people. So now the nectar is very enjoyable, but here when they see her beauty, hey, this is even more enjoyable. And because they want to, they are attracted to her. So, in order to create a good impression, they immediately just calm down. And everybody, they quieten down. And then they all not only quieten down, she speaks to them, you know, why are you fighting like this? You know, fighting will injure you. All of you are such heroic people. There is no need for you to fight like this. And as far as the nectar is to be divided, you can divide it fairly, equally among everyone. And Mohini Murti starts speaking so sweetly that first her appearance is captivating, and her sweet become her words are so captivating also. So then the asuras do something astonishing. Yes, the same nectar pot which they have been fighting for against the asuras who have with whom they have lived and fought together many wars before, they all take that nectar pot and just give it to Mohini. We may say, this is ridiculous. Who will do something like this? Something which you have been fighting for, just nonchalantly, willingly, we give it to some third person we don't even know. So this happens. So now this is a dramatic twist in the storyline. And to explain how the Devata Asuras could do something like this, the whole reason is that Mohini Murti's beauty is extremely captivating. So the description of the Mohini Murti's beauty is given not to evoke sensual desires within us. It is given there firstly because there has to be, in Kavya Shringar has to be there. And secondly, because through this, the dramatic twist in the story that is going to happen, that the asuras are going to just give up what they are fighting for. So that has to be highlighted. So for that purpose, this description comes over there. And so Mohini Murti is devastatingly beautiful, and her beauty devastates the intelligence of the asuras. So we don't want our intelligence to be devastated, so I won't describe her beauty. So just move on. Now when these asuras, they get completely bewildered, they just voluntarily hand over everything, the pot that they're fighting, to Mohini. When this happens, so Mohini says, oh, all of you, this nectar, this is very precious. Now you, it has to be honored respectfully. So honored respectfully means, so sometimes if somebody gives us prasad, even people who may not be devotees also, they have a little piety, they say, okay, let me wash my hands and come. Or they say, if you are wearing they are wearing some footwear, they'll take out the footwear. And then prasad is to be honored. Of course, when devotees become more devoted, then they forget these rules. And they follow another rule. That rule is prapti matrena bhoktavyam. As soon as you get prasad, consume it. But if something is very sacred, we normally prepare ourselves to, we purify ourselves so that we can honor it. So similarly, the devata, when Mohini Murti says, I'll divide it fairly to all of you, so the asuras and the devatas, now they all calm down. They didn't want to give any nectar to the devatas, but they start thinking that she is a greater nectar and we want to get her. They want to create a good, better impression on her. So what they do is, they all decide to take the nectar very amicably. And then she says that this nectar is very sacred. So they all go and they take a bath and they purify themselves, sanctify themselves, and they come out and sit down in lines to take the nectar. And Mohini Murti, she starts giving the nectar. The devatas are sitting on one line, the asuras are sitting on another line. And as they are sitting in one line, she starts with the devatas. And when she starts with the devatas, the asuras are so captivated by her, so spellbound in looking at her, that what she is doing, they just don't question it. Just don't question it at all. Hey, we are stronger. They came and signed an agreement with us. They came for the agreement with us. We should get the nectar first. So she just looks lovingly at them, sweetly at them, you know, enticingly at them. And she says, you know, these devatas, you know, they are actually like children. They can't control themselves. You can control yourself. So just wait. Now, she just signals like that and she just become completely paralyzed. Just can't think of anything else. The nature of the intelligence is that intelligence is not a static resource that we have. It's like sometimes if we have some money, we put in fixed deposit, then that money is, it's there constantly. But if you put some money in some shares, and especially in volatile shares, then today we have the money, tomorrow if the prices go down, the money goes down. We have very little money. The market, stock market crashes, we may have no money at all. So our intelligence is not like the money in the stock market, not in the fixed deposit. Our intelligence is like money in the stock market. What that means is, one day we may be very intelligent, but the next day the stock market crashes. Next day, say some temptation comes up and we get allured by it. So our intelligence goes down completely. So just because we are intelligent today doesn't mean we'll be intelligent tomorrow. And now there are unpredictable forces which may cause the stock market prices to go down. But what causes the stock of our intelligence to go down is quite predictable. What is it? It is actually contemplation on sense objects. In 2.62 and 63, Krishna tells how dhyayato vishayan pumsaha sangasteshu pajayate sangat sanjayate kamaha kamat krodho bhijayate krodhat bhavati sammoha sammohat smriti vibhrama smriti brahmashat buddhinasho buddhinashat pranashyati. So from dhyayato to buddhinashat, from contemplation to the destruction of the intelligence, to stupefaction. This is a chain. And what this means is that the more we contemplate on some sense object, the more the desire becomes stronger. And then that desire distorts our vision. The desire distorts our vision. That means that actually the same thing, if say we are seeing three objects, we are seeing A, B, C. Now, if we see C after we have seen A and B, our emotion towards C will be different than if we see C first and then B and A. Say an example, in the Bhagavad Gita, before the Kurukshetra war is about to begin, Arjuna comes in between the two armies. Senayor ubhayor madhye ratham sthapay me achyuta. He says, please establish my chariot in between the two armies. When Arjuna does that, now Arjuna could have at that time looked first at Duryodhana. And this Duryodhana, he insulted Draupadi. He defrauded Yudhishthira of his kingdom. He tried to poison Bhima. He tried to burn all of us. Now, if he had looked at Duryodhana first, then his reaction would have been different. But when he came in between, what happened? Bhishma Drona Pramukhtaha Sarvesham Cha Mahikshitam Bhishma Drona Pramukhtaha. Among all the warriors who were there, the first person he saw was Bhishma and Drona. Now, if somebody has to fight a war, at that time, they need to be internally tough. War is a difficult business, and one has to be internally tough at that time. So, if he had seen Duryodhana, his internal toughness would have been sustained or even increased. But he saw Bhishma and Drona first. And he had so much affection for them, so much reverence for them, that his internal toughness went down. He started softening. And then after that, even in looking at everyone else, he saw them, you know, first, if you see in 1.21 and 22, when he's describing, he says, Kairmaya sah yuddhavyam asmin rana samudyame yotsamana navekshaham yaete atra samagata. Who all have come to fight against me? Dhartharashtra se durbuddher yuddhe priyachikirshava. So who all have come here to please, to support that wicked son of Dhritarashtra, that is Duryodhana. So he is looking at them with Duryodhana at the center. These are all allies of Duryodhana. That Duryodhana is wicked and they are all allies. But when he comes in between and he looks, at that time his vision focuses on Bhishma and Drona. And then immediately after that, when he speaks, he says, oh, all of them are Swabandhavan, they are my relatives. What we see determines what we feel. Now, in a room, say if you are going to meet a group of people, and there are two groups of people who have some conflicts among each other, and when the two group has to have a meeting. Now, sometimes when there is a conflict, on the other side also there may be some friends of ours, some people with whom we are close to, some people whom we are very much against. So if in that group of people, if we focus on the people whom we are very much against, then immediately what will happen is our antipathy will awaken. And then after looking at that person, then we look at our friend also. Hey, you also belong to that group, huh? You know, you have betrayed me, you have disappointed me. On the other hand, if you look at that friend first, these are not my enemies, my own friend is over there. So then we will be much more amenable to talking and reconciling. So sometimes there may be a 99% difference between two people. But if there is to be any hope for reconciliation, we need to begin with the 1% commonality. If we begin with the 99% difference, then that 1% commonality will be completely overridden. If there is 50% commonality and 50% difference, then begin with the 50% commonality. So here the devatas, the devatas and the asuras, as they are sitting and they are watching. So the asuras, they just see Mohini, and when they see Mohini Murti, they are so captivated by her that actually now for them the nectar is the pot of nectar which they have fought for. So if they had looked at the pot of nectar and that had been the focus of their vision, hey, this nectar is being given to the gods, how can we allow that? We can't allow that. But their vision was completely captivated by the Mohini Murti, and they're looking, you know, oh, she is so beautiful, she is so graceful. You see how elegantly she's pouring out this nectar. So so when they were looking in this way, they just didn't notice anything else. So when we go into a situation, you know, our vision has to be guided by our intention. The situation guides our vision, then our intention can get sabotaged. When Arjuna was looking at the opposite army, if his vision had been guided by his intention, he would focus on Duryodhana first. But when the situation let the situation guide his vision, then what happened? He looked at Bhishma and Drona first and he weakened. So the point that I am making is that our intelligence is not a fixed resource. It's a changing resource. Its value changes. And the stock market, the stock of the intelligence goes down based on what we perceive. So when we contemplate sense objects, at that time our intelligence starts going down. And the more we contemplate the sense objects, the more the intelligence starts going down. I was talking with a devotee in the stock market. He said when stock starts going down, initially it's one stock goes down a little bit, and then another stock goes down a little bit, and then as few more stocks start going down, then panic starts over there. And when panic starts, everybody starts selling, and then the stock market might be going down like this, and after some time it just goes down like this, just crashes. So similarly for our intelligence, when it is going down, initially when we contemplate the sense objects, okay, it's no big deal, it's nice. Then from that, so dhyayato vishayan pumsa, that time, hey, you just look at something and then that's nice. That's sangaste shupajayate, and then sangat sanjayate kamaha. From that's nice, I want it. And then sankamat krodho bhijayate. Who says I can't have it? And then krodhat bhavati sammoha. We forget what is at stake. Sammoha, deluded. No, sometimes this is something is more important, something less important, but we just delusion. I don't care for anything else. Sammohat smuti vibrama. Sammoha means I don't care for anything else. Smuti vibrama means at that time we start thinking, in the past we may have got into a lot of trouble because of our indulgence. But as soon as I don't care, then whatever will make us care gets forgotten. So there is a selective memory wipeout. So we only remember the pleasure and we forget the trouble. And then actually our memory, not in terms of facts but in terms of experiences and what we have learned from it, that is the basis of our intelligence. Once our memory is lost, then our intelligence is lost. So I don't care. And whatever has happened in the past, I don't care for it. And then we get driven simply by the impulse. So in this case, of course, this principle Krishna which is taught in the Bhagavad Gita, it applies. Normally when it applies, it degrades people. But in this case, it actually helps a godly cause. Because the asuras get degraded. And then their intelligence get degraded. And then there are Rahu and Ketu. There are two asuras who are not that captivated. And when they notice Mohini Murti is actually, she is giving all the nectar to the devatas. So then they think, what to do? So they immediately take on the form of devatas. But Mohini Murti, she is in a female form, but she is still Vishnu. And with her chakra, she just foils their plans. And then at the end of it, when the whole nectar gets over, And then Mohini Murti turns around, the devatas are drinking this nectar. As they're drinking nectar, they're becoming stronger and stronger and stronger. And then Mohini Murti, she turns around, the asuras are still looking at her. They're so captivated by her and they don't even notice that the pot is empty. And then she turns towards them, smiles at them, and she turns the pot around, it's completely empty. And then their intelligence starts awakening and she just nonchalantly walks away from there. And the asuras get angry. And as Mohini Murti is going away from there, now she just goes away and they get so angry, they don't know what to do. Just turn around and start attacking the gods. Start attacking the gods, but now because the gods have drunk the nectar, they have become much stronger. And they completely, in the battle that happens, eventually Vishnu comes and helps again, but the asuras are defeated. Asuras are defeated and Mohini Murti does not fight over here. But she empowers the devatas and disempowers the asuras. And in this way, the asuras are completely baffled and defeated. So they are defeated actually by the beauty of Mohini Murti. And in this particular case, normally we consider the Lord is the source of illumination. The Lord is the source of liberation. But here, the Lord becomes the source of illusion. He becomes the source of illusion for the demonic. But by becoming a source of illusion, actually he saves the world from illusion. Because if the demonic had become in power, they would have spread adharma. They would have sent the world in illusion. And whatever Krishna does, if he is personally involved in doing something, it is ultimately for the good of everyone. He protects the devatas, he establishes dharma by that. Now he deceives the asuras, somebody might say. But the deception is for even the good of the asuras. Because when the asuras, the more, they are anyway going to be demonic. But the more power they will get, the more demonic they will become, the more damage they will do. Like earlier I said, if somebody is short-tempered, then if they are going to get angry, they are going to throw their hands and they are going to become angry, they are going to be aggressive. If somebody who is short-tempered, that person is given a machine gun. They can cause terrible damage. They can kill so many people that way. So that is one major reason for concern here in America, that people have guns, and in school sometimes terrible things happen because madmen go around with guns. So then somebody has demonic impulses. If they are externally given facilities to act on those impulses, then they can do far greater damage. If those facilities are taken away from them, then the demonic impulses will still be there, but they will not be able to cause so much damage. So now if the asuras had caused all this damage, then they are still under the law of karma. The law of karma acts for everyone. If somebody steps down from a 10-story building, they may forget gravity, but gravity will not forget them. So similarly, when there is the promise of pleasure available, and pleasure seems to be so easily available, people forget everything and they may just indulge, but still the law of karma applies. So Lord Vishnu benefited even the asuras by saving them from excessive empowerment, which would cause them to do more demonic activities. Now, after hearing the story, Lord Shiva becomes astounded and he says, I want to see the beauty of Mohini Murti. Now, how that story unfolds, that we'll discuss in tomorrow's class. So, I'll summarize what I spoke today. I spoke about how when the Lord, who is the source of illumination, of liberation, he becomes the source of illusion. How does that happen? So the Bhagavatam confronts our normal conceptions of right and wrong, of good and bad. That the demons can sometimes be better than the gods if the demon is a devotee, as happens in Ritrasur's case. Something which is bad can be good, sometimes failure can be a success and success can be a failure. So, the Lord acts for the good of everyone. Normally, people's good is furthered by taking them out of illusion. But sometimes, some people's good may be furthered by putting them in illusion. So, the Lord does good for everyone. And this particular pastime of Mohini Murti, he appears in a bewitching female form. And there is a cosmic battle in the universe which reflects the psychic battle within us between the people who are wise and the people who are otherwise. And in this battle, based on Kala, based on the influence of time, sometimes the gods may become weaker. At that time, strategically, they are told to make a peace pact, and we talk about nectar as the means, not for gaining immortality, but for its not absolute immortality, but relative immortality. In terms of our lifespan, there appears to be enormously long. But they also fear death and they try to avoid death by drinking nectar. So the asuras want that nectar, and Vishnu tells the devatas to tell them that we can get this nectar by churning the ocean. And when they get to the nectar eventually, after much trouble, then at the sight of that finishing line, shakes off the veneer of civilization that they have. And they start fighting, they start pushing away the devatas and start pushing away even the weaker asuras to get all the nectar for themselves. We discuss the difference between civilized and uncivilized people is not based on dress, but it's based on self-restraint. All of us have unhealthy impulses, but the virtuous people, in indulging in their impulses, they don't go beyond ethical limits. Whereas the vicious people, the demonic people, they just transgress all limits in their mad pursuit of pleasure. So I discuss different degrees in which people may express their anger, from just becoming silent to picking up a gun and shooting others in road rage. So civilization means that people need to be trained to restrain their impulses. So when they start fighting amongst each other, at that time, Lord Vishnu comes as the Mohini Murti. The explicit description is given there not to agitate the mind, but to fulfill the need for Shringar in Kavya, and to give an explanation of how such a dramatic twist in the storyline can happen. That her beauty is what deludes and devastates the intelligence of the asuras. And then I talked about how our intelligence is not like a fixed deposit in a, it's like a deposit in stock market. It can go down and go up very rapidly. And what causes the intelligence to go down is contemplation on the sense objects. So contemplation acts like a force which drags our intelligence down. What does contemplation do? Within the reality that we are seeing, if we see a particular thing first, then other things get relegated in the background and other things are seen through the filter of this. So when Arjuna saw Bhishma and Drona first, then everybody else he saw with affection. If he had seen Duryodhana first, he would have seen everybody with reservation, with the determination to fight. So we cannot change what is there in the outer world, but we can choose what we focus on in the outer world. If we let the situation determine our vision, then our intention will be sabotaged. But if we let the intention determine our vision, then within the situation, we look at the things which will help us move forward with our intention. And then the asuras got bewildered. They became bewildered because their vision shifted from the nectar pot to Mohini. And because they were so captivated by her, they wanted to get her now, that they just neglected everything else. And Mohini Murti, she gracefully gave the nectar to the gods, and then the asuras were deluded by her. Thus, the asuras tried to fight, but by that time they had been disempowered. The gods had been empowered because of having drunk the nectar, and eventually the cosmic order was restored. So, although Mohini Murti deluded the asuras, she deluded them for their own benefit. If somebody has unhealthy impulses, and then they have facilities to act on those impulses. If somebody is angry and they have a gun, they will cause havoc. So taking away the facilities from those who are deluded can ensure that they don't do things which worsen the delusion. So the Lord, who is the source of good for everyone, if somehow he becomes the source of illusion for someone, that is also for their good. That is to save them from illusion. Tomorrow we'll discuss how somebody is already good, they are not in illusion, if the Lord puts them in illusion, what is the purpose of that? That we'll discuss tomorrow. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Any questions or comments?
Hare Krishna.
Yes.
Thank you, Prabhu. Very interesting class, very insightful, thoughtful class, Prabhu. Prabhu, my question is like, you said intention and situation, right?
Yeah.
Sometimes we have to act based on the situation also, right?
Yeah.
It can enhance our intention also.
Yes. Okay. Because sometimes we have to act based on the situation also, and situation can also enhance our intention. Yes, certainly. When we say that, it's not that we are going to be blind to the situation. We have to be aware of the situation, no doubt. And we have to be responsive so that we respond appropriately to the situation. But the important thing has to be foremost in our mind. Say, I was recently talking with some devotees about the principles of communication. Communication means, let's say sometimes if we have to do some press interview, and we have 5 or 7 or 10 minutes. So at that time, we have to get certain messages across. And if people ask controversial questions, then sometimes some questions are so controversial, you actually cannot address them in a few minutes. So at that time, so the interviewer is asking certain questions. Now obviously we cannot neglect the interviewer's questions, but we can't address controversial questions in a short while. So before somebody goes into a high stakes communication session, they have to have their messages clear. 1, 2, 3, this is what I want to convey. And if somebody raises some other question, now I mean nominally address that question and come back to the essential point. This is the important thing. So for example, now we may say that sometimes in scripture there are some statements which are unbelievable, which are controversial, some things may seem fantastic. So like once Prabhupada was asked by some of his disciples, Prabhupada, in Bhagavatam it said that, say Maharaj Ugrasen had so many bodyguards, an astronomical number is described. Now if we tell this to the scholars ask, you know, where were they all living? Dwarka is such a small, where were they living? Where were their houses? Where were their restrooms? So now Prabhupada could have answered, Krishna's power is inconceivable, Krishna can do anything. But that is not the answer that is going to be acceptable to them. So Prabhupada answers, he says, among all the sections in the Bhagavatam, is that the only thing you found to speak to the scholars? So now there is a time to answer those questions, but if it's a short interaction, yes, see we can just say that yes, there are things in the scriptures which arise from a very different worldview. But the important thing is, scripture gives universal principles that can add value and provide us meaning and fulfillment in our life. And we focus on those principles. So we take the situation into account, but we don't let the situation alone determine our actions. See, another example could be, if we are going in a boat. Now we have an intention to get to the land. Now, if the waves are very, very strong, then sometimes going in that direction may be impossible. So we may have to go in some other direction just to avoid running into those waves. But even if we go in another direction, then as soon as those waves subside, then we will go back in the right direction. So our intention has to respond to the situation. But our intention cannot be determined only by the situation. If we go in a boat into the ocean and think, okay, wherever the waves are going, let me go there. Then we will not get anywhere. If we are committed to nothing, then we will be distracted by everything. So we do respond to the situation, no doubt. But we have to have our intention clear. Otherwise, the situation can just toss us here, there and everywhere. Does that answer your question?
Yes,
thank you. Hare Krishna. Any other questions?
Yes,
Yes.
So, there are some, like you said, Marthya, Amar, Chiranjeev and
Nitya.
So, so Prabhuji, Chiranjeev means we say to Hanuman and Ashwasthama, they are Chiranjeev. So, are they still there?
Okay, are Hanuman and Ashwatthama still there? Yeah, there are different characters who are having described as having different lifespans. So, certain characters have been told in the scripture that they will be living for a very long time. At the same time, when Kali Yuga grows, at that time, there are certain things which change. If we consider a computer system, like there is a big mainframe computer, then different people may have different levels of access. Say the owner of the company may have access to all the data in the computer. For somebody who is just a data operator, you can only enter the data, you can only add these files. These files, you can see them, but you cannot touch them. And sometimes some files may not even be visible. That it's those files are not only not at all seen also. So just like that, the computer can have different levels of access for people at different levels of authority. Similarly, the universe gives access to different people based on their karma. So that's why it is said that even if somebody goes to Swarga, they will not see the devatas there, because the devatas' body is subtle. It can be seen only by those who have an adhikar. I say sometimes in the yajnas it is described that devatas come and accept the sacrifice, but sometimes only they become visible. Other times they, in an invisible form, they take the sacrifice. So the point is that as Kali Yuga progresses, the access that the souls have to other aspects of the universe, that decreases. It's Kali is such a infectious force that we could say that if somebody gets a very serious disease, if there's serious contagious disease, then they are put in quarantine. They're separated from everyone else. So about maybe 15 years ago, I had got severe TB. So then for 6 months, I became a Jain sadhu. I put a mask on my face constantly to cover the mouth, not a germs to go out to anywhere else. So when somebody is very infected with a serious disease, then they are put in quarantine. So similarly, Kali, the infection of Kali is such a serious infection that the earth has been quarantined from the rest of the universe. That is why, whereas in the past there has been lot of interaction between the devatas would come to the earth, the asuras would come to the earth. But now, this part of the earth has been quarantined. And that's why we can't access these higher levels of reality. So even if Ashwatthama and Hanuman are living, even they are living, so they said, it's said that they are living, but it's not said where they are living. Even if you presume that they are living on the earth, they wouldn't be visible to us. But they could be living on some other level of the universe also. We don't know. Okay? Thank you. Yes, Prabhu.
Prabhuji, one question. When we are living in a day-to-day world, and when someone gets hurt, someone loses their material possessions, how can we tell them that whatever happened is good for you?
Okay.
So, if we are close to that person and we have to interact with him or her, how do we interact in a way that we try to console the person, but at the same time, not become too indifferent that they start saying that devotees are not really concerned and compassionate about others?
That's true. So, if somebody has suffered a great adversity, lost all their possessions, so can we really tell them that everything that happens is everything is good or whatever like that? How can we be sensitive to them? Firstly, there is this saying that everything that happens is good, or everything that happens is for good. There's a big difference between the two. Everything that happens is good means even the terrible things that are happening, say, you know, somebody gets murdered, somebody gets abused, somebody gets violated, that is not good. nobody tells Draupadi when she is dishonored that everything that happens is good. So I think this is a misrepresentation to say that everything that happens is good. God is all good, but everything that happens is not necessarily God's will. It is what God sanctions. Prabhupada writes in the Bhishma pastime that actually in this world everything that happens is within God's plan. It is not that everything is God's plan. That what is the difference between within God's plan and is God's plan? That in this world there are multiple forces in action, and each of these forces has been given their jurisdiction. So for example, each soul has a free will. When that soul has the free will, that soul by its past karma will get a certain area on which to use that free will. So an ordinary citizen will have a certain area of influence. A head of state will have a much, much greater area of influence. So that area of influence which they have got, that is determined by their past karma. And if somebody within that area of influence misuses their free will, they can cause terrible harm to others. Now, that is not Krishna's plan. It is within Krishna's plan that they have that area of influence by the law of karma, which is under Krishna. But if they are misusing it, they are hurting others. It is not that Krishna wants them to be hurt. Krishna wants them to hurt others or wants others to be hurt. So we do acknowledge that bad things happen in life. And it's not that we have to say that everything that happens is good. So similarly, sometimes nature might lead to some calamities. So the elements have their own force in this world. And sometimes those elements may act in terrible ways. So generally, there is not much use when somebody is suffering to talk with them about karma. At an intellectual level, it is a reasonable explanation for making sense of life's sufferings. But at an emotional level, when a person is undergoing suffering, it actually adds insult to injury.
Yes.
So, and nowhere in scripture do we see this. Now the Pandavas may themselves say, for example, oh, we must have done some bad karma because of which you are suffering. But nobody tells them it is your because of your bad karma you are suffering. Nobody tells Draupadi, you know, you must have done some bad karma in the past because of which you have got went through this dishonor. No. So at that time, our focus is not so much to speak philosophy as to fulfill the purpose of philosophy. And the purpose of philosophy is to help us understand that how God loves every one of us. So when somebody is suffering terribly, we can say that why things happen in the world, we don't know. Nobody knows actually. And we may say we know it's karma. Well, we don't know what karma it is. We don't know who has done what karma. So how can we be so confident? So we can focus on the point that the cause of suffering in this world is unknown. But God can be the cure for our suffering. In fact, the Bhagavatam also adopts this humble attitude where when the cow and the bull are being persecuted by Kali personified as a king, and Parikshit Maharaj intervenes and then he asks the cow and bull, what is the cause of your suffering? And at one level, this whole question can seem absurd. Parikshit Maharaj has seen Kali beating the cow, beating the bull. Why is he asking what is the cause of your suffering? And the cow and bull, their answer is also, actually, different philosophers have different understandings of what is the cause of suffering. And some people say this, some people say that, some people say that. And hearing all these philosophers, we are confused and we don't know what is the cause of suffering. So what does it mean? It means the Bhagavatam is telling us, don't obsess so much on the immediate reality. So we need to look beyond it. So we don't have to get into, if somebody is suffering, no need to get into karma unless it helps. And most situations, at least at the time of hurt, it doesn't help. So at that time, we can only tell them that whatever difficulty is there, if you can take shelter of God, that will give you inner calmness. That will help you to get inner strength. So God is not up there somewhere causing suffering or even letting suffering happen to us. God is in here with us, and He can help us to deal with the sufferings that we may face. And if people can do that, anybody at that time of distress, they can pray, they can chant, that will calm them down. And with that calmness, they can deal better with the situation. So if we can't be grateful for all situations, but we can be grateful in all situations. This situation is bad. I can't be grateful for this situation. But in all situations means, even when something bad has happened, at that time, we can look at all the good that is still there in our life. If somebody gets some terrible disease, somebody gets cancer, then you can't say cancer is good. What we can say, look at it, okay, there are still so many good things in my life. And then we can look specifically at the good things that help us to deal with the bad thing. Oh, I have reasonably good health overall. My health is sturdy. I got health insurance. I have a supportive family. I have a supportive community. This disease, this particular form of cancer is curable. Look at the good that helps us to deal with the bad. And then sometimes, from the bad also, good may come in future. So when the vision gets caught in the bad, look for the good in the life. Look for the specific good that helps us to deal with the bad. And then look for, be patient, and we look for the good that may emerge from the bad. Sometimes a bout with cancer helps people to realign their priorities and treasure that which is more, that is most valuable. So that way, if we focus not on the cause but the solution, and we become a part of the solution. So there is a time to speak philosophy, there is a time to educate, and there is a time to commiserate. Commiserate means be empathic, be understanding. So when Abhimanyu is killed, Krishna doesn't tell Arjuna that don't cry because the soul is eternal. Krishna actually very empathically supports him over there, encourages him, consoles him, and rebuilds him. So we have to see that we are here to help others. Now, if the philosophy can be a tool for helping others, we use the philosophy. If not, then just by our presence, by our humanity, by our being there to be with them in whatever way we can, that way we can help them. So if somebody is suffering terribly, so we have to embody Krishna's love before we can embody Krishna's wisdom. If we start embodying Krishna's wisdom, Krishna's message, but that makes us hard-hearted, insensitive, then we actually alienate people instead of attracting people towards Krishna. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you.
Hari Bhagavan. Shall we stop here? Any other questions? Okay.
Question is, so we are surrounded with sense objects and we keep seeing them, and the contemplation of the sense objects starts the downfall. And how to avoid that, or what's a positive step so that we don't start the contemplation of the senses in this way?
Okay. How to avoid contemplating on the sense objects when they are all around us? Broadly, I would say three things: intention, intelligence, and vigilance. Intention means, say, if we have something important to do in our life. Say, if somebody is going to a shopping area, but they have to go for some urgent meeting, they just go one place, they'll buy whatever they want to buy and then move on. But if somebody has the whole day free, and then they think, let me just wander around the shopping area, then when they wander around, I can buy this also, I can buy that also, I can buy that also. There are people who are what is called shopaholics, like alcoholics. They shop till you drop. So if we have a strong intention, this is what I am going to do. So that driving purpose will enable us to not pay much attention to distractions. So we have to, that's why by the practice of bhakti and by the understanding of, by associating with devotees who have strong desire to serve Krishna, if our intention becomes strong, then the stronger our intention, the weaker becomes the power of the distraction on us. The second thing is intelligence. That means that although we can't remove the sense objects from our visual horizon or our sensual horizon, but if our intelligence is well nourished by the study of Shastra, then we know the consequences. So Krishna says that which tastes like nectar in the beginning will taste like poison in the end. So with our senses will only show us the initial nectar, but it is our intelligence which will tell us there is poison afterwards. Therefore, regular studying of Shastra will nourish our intelligence. And third is vigilance. Vigilance means that we have to be vigilant and we have to be alert to our specific triggers. It's not that the same sense objects agitate everyone. For some people, if they go to a shopping mall, they may not be very tempted. But if they go to a food mall, they'll get very tempted. Some people, if they go to they are watching TV, you know, sports may not tempt them, but movies may tempt them a lot. So each of us has our own temptations, our own weaknesses, and there are certain things which trigger us. So then we have to be aware of our triggers, and we have to stay away from those triggers. So others may not be agitated by those triggers. Say somebody has got diabetes. Now others may take sweets, but if that person takes sweets, they will suffer much more than anybody else. So therefore, for them, they have to be vigilant. I cannot take this. So similarly for us, if we do self-observation, then we will ourselves know what are the triggers that allure us, and then we can guard ourselves from those triggers. So intelligence, intention and vigilance. Intention, intelligence and vigilance can protect us. Okay? Thank you. Hare Krishna. So maybe we can talk personally afterwards. So thank you very much. Shri Prabhupada.